GOP says basically black schools are a pipeline to a student becoming an inmate. Here's the spirit that it was offered.
You've got crappy schools. You're not only, your schools are not only dropout factories, they're inmate factories. You can shake your head and disagreement all you want to, Mr. Allen, it's just the fact.
I don't agree that the D.C. public schools are inmate factories.
So you're telling me all of them are excellent?
No, I'm not saying all of them are excellent, but I would not say that they are factories for crime.
Let's put up his picture for mass. Let me explain something to the United States Representative Gary Palmer, who currently serves in Alabama. Mr. Palmer, obviously you are confused. You see, school systems, sir, are a reflection of the socioeconomic environment around the school. That socioeconomic environment has a massive influence as to the academic prowess and the educational attainment of the student. In other words, if a student doesn't have food when they go home, that has an adverse impact on their ability to do homework and to learn outside of the class. If you do not address the holistic dynamic related to the other issues, you are simply putting a Band-Aid on a wound. So while you may blame schools for that, please understand your position is that of a policymaker and problem solver. This is a problem worth solving. Simply saying that they are creating prisoners is red meat for your base. The title of the hearing was Overdue Oversight of the Capital City Park One. News One writer Zach Lindley remarked, if Republicans are really concerned with overdue oversight in D.C., then certainly part two will be about citing D.C. officials spreading false voter fraud propaganda in order to undermine the democratic system, causing Americans from inmate factories to attempt an overthrow of the government, right? So the D.C. council chair, let's put him up, seen engaging with Palmer's ugly remarks was Phil Mendelson. Following the hearing, Phil said in a statement to NBC News, the suggestion that D.C. public schools are inmate factories is racist and offensive to our parents. It overlooks the dedicated teachers and it typecasts our children as if they cannot learn. Let me echo that point. Let me echo that point. My mother, one of my adoptive mothers, is a school teacher. Completely changed my life. Gave me an appreciation for education I never would have had if it had not been for my experience with her in that household. But the reality is, she also taught at a school at one point that was underperforming. It was underperforming not because you did not have great educators. It was underperforming because you did not have great opportunities through policy in the local neighborhood. Right. We needed to have wraparound services. We needed to have tutorial programs that did not cost money. We needed to have food options after 3 p.m. and sometimes even before breakfast, believe it or not. Those things were required. And so without those support services, it was very difficult to create an academic enhancement via testing scores or academic grades. There's more. In fact, the information appears to be incorrect. While D.C. public school enrollment has been rising, the D.C. public school government website supports the growing confidence with performance data following over a decade of recent trends. Now watch this. For the ninth year, D.C. public schools has continued steady growth on the NAEP TUDA, which assesses and compares student performance across urban school districts in large cities. Since the 2009 DCPS has increased the percentage of students scoring proficient in every grade subject and decreased the percentage of students scoring below basic. The numbers are moving in the right direction. This data shows that students are trending towards college, not the penitentiary. But the real problem may lie in the inequitable and unequal opportunities. Let's break that down. Substantial achievement gaps between white students and their African-American and Latinx counterparts have closed slightly in reading. Many students attend racially isolated schools. Half of the city's white students attend private institutions because the families can afford them. Let's put up the graph. One of the integral measures of opportunity is an access to food. Food. One third of DC does not have enough food to feed themselves or their family. You're looking at a graphic from the Capital Food Bank breaking down how many families, how many children cannot eat a decent meal every day. The Capital City Food Bank shows families affected by food insecurity are predominantly Black and Hispanic. And that, as a result, these families suffer in their ability to complete their education. I've been a school teacher for a while. I was a high school teacher before I became a college professor. I understand these numbers quite well. When politicians say things like this is just a bad school, understand there are very few bad schools in the world. There are a couple, I grant you that, but very few. It's really about the socioeconomic environment that must be addressed external of the school system. And if that's not addressed, a politician yelling that somehow this is simply a way to create inmates without providing a remedy, without talking about the inequities involved, once again, nothing but red base talk, not remedy talk. Rickey, thoughts here?
Systemic racism at its best.
Yeah.
You know, that's why we have to continue to be vigilant and get out and vote. We have to get out and vote people like that, you know, because we got to show up for midterm elections and local elections, and you don't have people up there representing your state, which is where I'm from, Alabama, with that particular racist mindset. And when they think of us like that, Dr. Richard, they vote against anything that support what we, you know, support and support what we're trying to do, you know, because they always have this thing where pull yourself up by the bootstrap and whatever. But hell, if you don't have nothing to eat and you don't have the resources, then, you know, how can some kids make it? And that's just really sad to hear him say something like that. I'm not, definitely not surprised. You know, I'm shocked when somebody actually have some empathy and try to do the right thing. But they, you know, just sit on a high horse and they just pass judgment. And that's the way they, a lot of them think, and that's the way they are. And it ain't nothing you can do to change it. But the only way you change stuff like that is to get out and vote.
That's right. Well said. You know, I spoke to DeKalb County commissioners that's in the metropolitan area of Atlanta not too long ago. And I was their speaker for their morning routine. And I reminded them that policy is light, but policy can also be darkness. When you put a plant inside of a dark building, that plant starts to wilt. It starts to die. If you put a plant outside, 100% of the time, that plant grows into the direction of sunlight.
Absolutely.
If you take that same plant, dear brother, put it inside and allow artificial light to be the only light present, that plant will grow in the direction of artificial light every time. The point is, when we don't have attractive options through policy, we allow our young people to grow in the direction of artificial light. But if we can take them out of that environment of that building, that darkness, and put them outside where real light prevails, 100% of the time, they will grow in the direction of that real light.